Hi, today we are going to understand what are special economic zones. So, what is a special economic zone? It is a zone, it is an area in a country that is subject to different economic regulations than other regions within the same country. So, the special economic zones or economic regulations tend to be conducive to and attract foreign direct investment. Now, this foreign direct investment refers to any investment made by a firm or individual in one country into business interests located in another country, and we have done that already. Now, when a country or individual conducts business in a special economic zone, there are typically additional economic advantages for them, including tax incentives and the opportunity to pay lower tariffs. Special economic zones are typically created in order to facilitate rapid economic growth by leveraging tax incentives to attract foreign investment and spark technological advancement. While many countries have set up special economic zones, China has been the most successful in using these special economic zones to attract the foreign capital. Now, as per the definition of special economic zones, it is determined individually by each country. So, according to World Bank in 2008, the modern day special economic zone typically includes a geographically limited area, usually physically secured, that is a fenced in one, single management or administration, eligibility for benefits based upon physical location, within the zone, separate customs area or duty-free benefits, and a streamlined procedure. Now, if we go in the history for special economic zones, the free zones and entry ports have been used for centuries to guarantee free storage and exchange along trade routes. Modern special economic zones appeared from the late 1950s in industrial countries. The first was in Shannon Airport in Clare, Ireland. From the 1970s onwards, zones providing labor-intensive manufacturing have been established starting in Latin American and East Asia. The first in China, following the opening of China in 1979 by Deng Xiaoping, was the Shenzhen Special Economic Zone, which encouraged foreign investment and simultaneously accelerated industrialization in this region. So these zones attracted investment from multinational corporations. A recent trend has been for African countries to set up special economic zones in partnership with China. Now, if we want to understand the special economic zones, they are actually or usually created in order to facilitate rapid economic growth in certain geographical regions. So this economic growth is accomplished by leveraging tax incentives as a way of attracting foreign dollars and technological advancement. Special economic zones may also increase export levels for the implementing country and other countries that supply it with intermediate products. However, there is a risk that countries may abuse the system and use it to retain protectionist barriers in the form of taxes and fees. Special economic zones can also create a high level of bureaucracy due to their regulatory requirements. This can have the effect of funneling money away from the system, making it less efficient. While there are benefits for businesses, individuals, or entities operating within a special economic zone, the macroeconomic and socioeconomic benefits for a country using a special economic zone strategy are subject to the debate. The first special economic zone appeared in late 1950s in industrialized countries. They were designed to attract foreign investment from multinational corporations. The first was in, as I've told you, in the Shannon Airport. The term special economic zone can include free trade zones, export processing zones, free economic zones, industrial parks or industrial estates, free ports, bonded logistics parks, and urban enterprise zones. First of all, what are free trade zones? So they are a class of special economic zones, and it is a geographic area where goods may be imported, stored, handled, manufactured, or reconfigured and re-exported under specific customs regulation and generally not subject to customs duty. So free trade zones are generally organized around major seaports, international airports, and national frontiers, and areas with many geographical advantages for trade. The World Bank also defines free trade zones as duty-free areas offering warehousing, storage, distribution facilities for trade, transshipment, and re-export operations. Free trade zones can also be defined as labor-intensive manufacturing centers that involve the import of raw materials or components and the export of factory products. But this is a dated definition as more and more free trade zones focus on service industries such as software, back office operations, research, and financial services. According to PhD, the term should be understood in the meaning, the International Convention on Simplification and Harmonization of Customs Procedures. They use the term free zones, which the revised convention describes as part of territory of contracting party. Herein, any goods introduced are generally regarded insofar as import duties and taxes are concerned as being outside the customs territory. The free trade zones have more recently been also called special economic zones in some countries. The special economic zones have been established in many countries as testing grounds for implementation of liberal market economy principles. So special economic zones are viewed as instruments to enhance the acceptability and the credibility of the transformation policies and to attract domestic and foreign investment. The change in terminology has been driven by the formation of World Trade Organization, which prohibits members from offering certain types of fiscal incentives to promote the export of goods. Thus, why the term export processing zones is no longer used with newer zones. For example, India converted all of its export processing zones to special economic zones in 2000. In 1999, there were 43 million people working in about 3,000 free trade zones spanning in 116 countries and producing clothes, shoes, sneakers, electronics, and toys. The basic objectives of economic zones are to enhance foreign exchange earnings, develop export-oriented industries, and generate employment opportunities. Sometimes the domestic government pays part of the initial cost of factory setup, loosens environmental protections and rules regarding negligence and the treatment of workers, and promises not to ask payment of taxes for the next few years. When the taxation-free years are over, the corporation that set up the factory without fully assuming its cost is often able to set up operations elsewhere for less expense than the taxes to be paid, giving it leverage to take the host government to the bargaining table with more demands. But parent companies in the United States are rarely held accountable. The political writer Naomi Klein has also criticized the transient nature of free trade zones, noting that the factory closures connected to 1997 Asian financial crisis. She criticized the low wages and long hours, citing work days of 12 or more hours in Indonesia, Philippines, southern China, and Sri Lanka circa in 2000. Also, world experience contains examples of unsuccessful attempts to implement such incentives. The Parliament of Ukraine adopted a law which created a free trade zone on the whole territory of Republic Crimea. According to Yevhen Marianek, the decision is debatable not only from a legal standpoint but also from an economic point of view. This territory is temporarily occupied, for which the world community has imposed a sanction regime. Accordingly, there are no state guarantees, real preferences, and investment attractiveness. The second ones in special economic zones are export processing zones. So, an export processing zone or an EPZ is an area set up to enhance commercial and industrial exports by encouraging economic growth through investment from foreign entities. Incentives such as tax exemptions and a barrier-free environment are the main attractions of export processing zones. So, the main goals and benefits of export processing zones are growth from foreign exchange earnings through non-traditional exports, creation of jobs to assist in income generation and develop labor skill sets, the attraction of direct foreign investment, and fostering of transfer of technology. An export processing zone is a special type of free trade zone usually set up in developing countries by their governments to promote industrial and commercial exports. According to World Bank, an export processing zone is an industrial estate, usually a fenced in area of 10 to 300 hectares, that specializes in manufacturing for export. It offers firms free trade conditions and a liberal regulatory environment. Its objectives are to attract foreign investors, collaborators, and buyers who can facilitate entry into the world market for some of the economy's industrial goods, thus generating employment and foreign exchange. Most free trade zones are located in developing countries like Brazil, Colombia, India, Indonesia, El Salvador, China, Philippines, Malaysia, Bangladesh, Nigeria, Pakistan, Mexico, the Dominican Republic, Costa Rica, Honduras, Guatemala, Kenya, Sri Lanka, Mauritius, and Madagascar all have export processing zones programs. In 1997, 93 countries had set up export processing zones, employing 22.5 million people, and 5 years later, in 2003, export processing zones in 116 countries employed 43 million people. The export processing zones first appeared in 19th century in the form of free trade zones at ports locating in Singapore, Hong Kong, and Gibraltar. Formally implemented in the 1930s, export processing zones encourage foreign investment in a country. By the 1970s, export processing zones gained popularity to the point where many countries use the mechanism to boost their economy through investment from more advanced nations. In 2006, approximately 130 countries founded over 3,500 export processing zones, and some of these zones were so extensive that residential neighborhoods were actually established within the zone, such as in Chinese special economic zones. Export processing zones have now evolved to the point where they can include resorts, designated finance zones, technological parks, and centers dedicated to the logistics. What are the features of export processing zones? So, although export processing zones are located in different geographic regions, they do share some commonalities. The companies based in export processing zone tend to be benefited from tax concessions that are generally long-term in nature. Secondly, imports of materials and goods for export are duty-free. Also, while parts of countries that do not contain export processing zones can remain underdeveloped in terms of technology and infrastructure. The export processing zones are fitted with advanced communication facilities and enhanced infrastructure. So these zones also provide subsidies for utilities and rent to their occupants. Export processing zones can accommodate both domestic and foreign firms. They even offer the opportunity for joint venture operations. The zones are typically located in the vicinity of ports of air and sea, therefore making the import and export process more convenient. Companies do not require as much government approval for practices as firms outside of the zone, with labor laws being more flexible. Differentiating factors of export processing zones are related to the management and quality of goods, services provided, and facilities. Export processing zones can be managed either publicly or privately. What are the disadvantages of export processing zones? So there are significant benefits associated with establishment of the EPZs with countries such as China, Indonesia, and South Korea, boasting great benefits. However, countries like Philippines have faced poor performance from the EPZs. In this example, the cost of establishment of the facilities has outweighed the gains in the profits. The other disadvantages could be the labor that is skewed mainly towards the female population, leaving the problem of unemployment of the male population unresolved. Now, in some situations, employees work excessive hours in unsafe conditions, such as extreme heat around faulty machinery and in buildings that are not routinely inspected and maintained. Also, the wages are typically low, often below that of required country minimum wage. And most employees have to accept the previously mentioned working conditions as trade unions and labor movements are not allowed. Now, due to the competitive nature of the EPZs, workers often cannot expect any improvement in conditions as operating costs are purposely kept low to attract investors. The third ones are free economic zones. So the free economic zones or the territories, free economic territories, are a class of special economic zones designated by the Trade and Commerce Administrations of various countries. The term is used to designate areas in which companies are taxed very lightly or not at all to encourage economic activity. The taxation rules are determined by each country. The World Trade Organization Agreement on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures has content on the conditions and benefits of the free zones. The free economic zones, which are sometimes referred to as free trade zones, are territories mapped out by governments to designate areas that have little or no taxation. Designated to stimulate economic activity, these free economic zones effectively exist outside the borders and customs controls of their home country. Many free economic zones are situated near big shipping ports, known as free ports, which offer organizations easy access to international shipping and other domestic transport links such as railroads and highways. Some special economic zones are called free ports. Sometimes they have historically been endowed with favorable customs regulations, such as free port of Trieste, as Britain was proposing the creation of 10 free ports after leaving the European Union in early 2020. The European Union was clamping down on 82 free zones after finding that their special status has aided the financing of terrorism, money laundering, and organized crime. Now, why do free ports or FEZs exist? Now, these free economic zones exist to stimulate economic productivity by making import and export trade more attractive through the aforementioned tax breaks and other incentives. From a practical standpoint, suppliers and retailers use free economic zones to store surplus or safety stock with the option to defer payment of customs duty or tariffs. Free economic zones can also be a catalyst for boosting technical skills and driving innovation, especially in high competitive industries such as automobile components and aerospace. Now, what are the main types of free economic zones? The first ones are free trade zones, typically located near shipping ports or airports, sometimes known as free ports, and are known for eliminating duties and tariffs on imports and re-exports. The other ones are export processing zones, known for facilitating exports as well as re-exports. Then we have special economic zones focusing on both domestic and international development and financial success. Special economic zones also offer a wide variety of incentives, including tax exemptions, speedier administrative procedures, and access to infrastructure. Also, the industrial zones, like used for certain industries such as textiles or food and beverages, with the infrastructure in the zone adapted for their specific requirements. Far from being a novel concept, free economic zones have a rich history dating back as far as ancient Greece and Rome, where certain traders were given exemption from import and export taxes. In medieval times, ports in southern England were awarded tax exemptions And in the 19th century, tax breaks were given to alcohol and tobacco imports in bonded warehouses. It wasn't until the 20th century that free economic zones were employed as a conscious means for driving economic growth, timed with the rise of globalization. During the Great Depression, for example, the US deployed foreign trade zones to relieve exporters from high tariffs imposed by Smoot-Hawley Act in 1930. Today, there are more than 700 free ports and free economic zones scattered around the world, including more than 230 foreign trade zone projects across the United States, which handles $756 billion worth of imports and exports each year. Which are these zones? The special economic zones: the Sri City Multi-Product SEZ in Andhra Pradesh, SEEPS in Mumbai, Marg Swarnabhumi SEZ for Engineering and Multi-Services Tamil Nadu, and Inspira Pharma and Renewable Energy Park, Aurangabad, Maharashtra. These are the special economic zones in India. Now, these free economic zones have several advantages as well as disadvantages. The major advantage being the free economic zones can help to stimulate economic activity. In the United Kingdom, for instance, construction group Mays predicted that established post-Brexit free ports could boost the economy by $10.2 billion per annum. Also, the governments often include additional incentives to free economic zone users, including reduced regulation, lower administrative burden, and direct financial incentives. This speeds up the flow of international trade by cutting down on bureaucracy. Free economic zones give organizations more control over the production as well as distribution of their products. So these have been the advantages of free economic zones. But what are the disadvantages? So the main disadvantage is that by adopting light regulation, free economic zones could provide lucrative opportunities for criminals engaged with the trading of counterfeit goods, money laundering, or smuggling of illicit substances. One of the other disadvantages is that a recent OECD report suggested that each additional free economic zone within a country increases the number of fake exports by 6.9%. Also, the supposed economic benefits of free economic zones are hotly disputed by academics and government agencies, who argue that there is simply not enough evidence available to know for certain whether free economic zones have a net positive or negative effect on a country's economy. The coronavirus pandemic has left economies around the world in tatters. As governments look for ways to quickly drive economic recovery, it's predicted that these special economic zones could be the answer to stimulating trade and generating new investment in the United States. Next type of these special economic zones are industrial parks. So an industrial park, also known as industrial estate, trading estate, is an area zoned and planned for the purpose of industrial development. An industrial park can be thought of as a heavyweight version of business park or office park, which has offices in light industries rather than heavy industries. What are the benefits of these industrial parks? So these industrial parks are basically generally located on the edges or outside or outskirts of the main residential areas of a city, and they are normally provided with good transportation access, including road and rail. So one such example in the large number of industrial estates located along the River Thames in the Thames Gateway area of London. Industrial parks are usually located close to transport facilities, especially where more than one transport modes coincide, including highways, railroads, airports, and ports. Another common feature of a North American industrial park is a water tower, which helps to hold enough water to meet the park's demands and for firefighting purposes, and also advertises the industrial park and locality, as usually the community's name and logo are painted on its surface. So this idea of setting land aside through this type of zoning has many purposes. One, by concentrating dedicated infrastructure in a delimited area to reduce the per business cost of that infrastructure. And such infrastructure include roadways, railroads, sidings, ports, high power electric supplies, and often includes three phase electric power, high end communication cables, large volume water supplies, and high volume gas lines. Now, to attract new businesses by providing an integrated infrastructure in one location. Also, the eligibility of industrial parks are for benefits, and then also to set apart industrial users from urban areas to try to reduce the environmental and social impact of the industrial users. One more purpose can be to provide for localized environmental controls that are specific to the needs of an industrial area. What's benchmarking? So for the manufacturing companies located in industrial parks, the performance of industrial park operators is important. As the cost for infrastructure and services charged by the industrial park operator is a serious factor for the competitiveness of the manufacturing companies. About the criticism, the different industrial parks fulfill these criteria to differing degrees. Many small communities have established industrial parks with only access to a nearby highway and with only the basic utilities and roadways. So public transportation options may be very limited or completely non-existent. Also, the industrial parks in developing countries such as Pakistan face a myriad of additional difficulties. These include the availability of a skilled workforce and the clustering together of radically different industrial sectors like pharmaceuticals and heavy engineering, and which often leads to unfavorable outcomes for quality-centered industries. Then what are the variations in industrial parks? So an industrial park specializing in biotechnology, for example, is called a biotechnology industrial park. It may also be known as bio-industrial park or eco-industrial cluster. Flatted factories exist in cities like Singapore and Hong Kong where land is scarce. So these are typically similar to flats but house individual industries instead. Flatted factories have cargo lifts and roads that serve each level, providing access to each factory lot. Then the fifth one of the special economic zones is free ports. So some special economic zones are also known as free ports. Sometimes they have historically been endowed with favorable customs regulations, such as the free port of Trieste. As Britain was proposing the creation of 10 free ports after leaving the European Union in early 2020, the European Union was clamping down on 82 free zones after finding that their special status had aided the financing of terrorism, money laundering, as well as organized crime. Then we have bonded logistics park. Now, what are these kinds of park? These are type of special economic zones that have trade arrangements which are similar to that of bonded warehouse, but over a specific geographic area. So sometimes with international port capabilities, goods may be stored, manipulated, or undergo manufacturing operations without payment of duty. China's bonded logistics park have similar rules to free trade zones. That's another specific type of special economic zone, except for export value added tax refund. Export value added tax refund is eligible for a Chinese company once their goods enter the park. There are various locations in China, that is Zhangjiajiang Bonded Logistics Park, Jiangsu Province, and Yanshan Port Bonded Logistics Park, Guangdong Province. Now, what are urban enterprise zones? So these are an area in which policies to encourage economic growth and development are implemented. Urban enterprise zone policies generally offer tax concessions, infrastructure incentives, and reduced regulations to attract investments and private companies into the zones. They are a type of special economic zone where companies can locate free of certain local, state, and federal taxes and restrictions. Urban enterprise zones are intended to encourage development in deprived neighborhoods through tax and regulatory relief to entrepreneurs and investors who launch business in the area. They are common in United Kingdom and United States. In other countries, regions with similar economic policies are often referred as export procession zones, tax and duty-free zones, and special economic zones, most predominantly present in China and India. About the history, the 1970s witnessed a shift in city planning, leaving behind post-war Keynesian policies and entering an era of growth machine. Urban planning had thrived during the 1950s and 60s. Planning was fostered by a period of constant economic and physical growth. The economic recession of 1970s and 80s was compelled to transform the nature of urban planning. This shift was specially marked in United Kingdom when the strong capitalist economy shifted following the Great Recession. Britain lost its core economic motive, that is manufacturers. In an urban context, cities had to create growth at any cost. Due to the stagflation of the economy, the British Center of Policy Studies and the American Heritage Foundation challenged the theory of Keynesianism, which consists of a mixed economy in the private sector, accompanied by the government interventions and regulations. City planning stopped regulating and controlling growth and started promoting that growth by any possible means through tax concessions, deregulation, or infrastructure incentives. By encouraging urban growth, city authorities were expecting to boost the economy, reduce unemployment rates, and the progression of decay of its core cities. In the theory, actually, the enterprise zone concept evolved from a combination of theories, policies, and social forces. The philosophy is most closely associated with the theory of supply-side economics and the assumption that employers will respond positively to tax incentives and reduced government regulation. The enterprise zone philosophy suggests that by encouraging the production of goods, investment will improve, therefore, the supply of goods and services, and the providing of job opportunities will increase accordingly. As policy mechanism, enterprise zones are proposed to stimulate economic activity in the decaying areas. When compared with other areas, these areas have higher unemployment rates, lower income level, lower employment opportunities, vacant land, and decayed building and infrastructures. Enterprise zone programs provide the incentives to businesses to overcome economic obstacles that hinder economic growth. So these have been various types of special economic zones and their implications in the world. These are the references. Thank you for listening.